Roshnara Ali.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. It's a real privilege to have you in the chair for this debate, which will be the last time you sit in the chair. Yeah. I join my colleagues across the House in the tributes they've paid already, both today and previously. And I want to pay a personal tribute to all the work you've done to transform this House for the better. You have been a powerful advocate on so many issues, including human rights, which is an issue close to my heart. You've also championed our values of equality and fairness and justice, and you stood up against those who seek to inflame division and hatred in our country, including one president. And when the decision to invite him to this House came up, you rightly pointed out that we have a reputation to keep in defending against racism and sexism and standing up for equality before an independent judiciary. I know I'm summarising what you said, but it's important that we remember the courage and bravery in which you held to those standards. I hope that whoever succeeds you will build on your work and legacy and have the courage to stand up for what is right and decent and hold the executive to account and stand up for the sovereignty of our parliament. So from the bottom of my heart, thank you for everything you have done and all the support you've provided members from across the House. I'd also like to pay tribute to Reverend Rose Hudson Wilkins for all that she has done, as this is also her last day. She has contributed so much for this country and particularly here in this Parliament and of course my part of London. And we wish her the very best of luck in her new role. Mr. Speaker, we are here to debate the policy of succession in social housing. Social housing, whether council housing or social landlords housing, is the bedrock of many successful communities in my constituency of Bethnal Green and Bow and in many other parts of the country. It is important to remind ourselves of the original purpose of social housing. It was not only to provide a safety net for the poorest people, a last resort for the most vulnerable and desperately in need. The purpose of social housing was to provide safe, stable, affordable homes for all on middle and low incomes, often close to city centres and sources of work as an alternative to rip-off rents and exploitation. That need hasn't gone away. That principle should be maintained. But it has been under threat for a very long time. And not just homes, but communities where the same families live through the life cycle, growing together, helping each other out, putting down roots and building real communities and a real community spirit. That is the spirit of social housing in my constituency and has been for generations. And it has been a springboard for social mobility and aspiration and success. As the then Housing Minister Nye Bevan said, the goal was the living tapestry of a mixed community. And our goal should be mixed communities with people of different incomes and backgrounds living amongst one another, not monocultures or sink estates. Social housing provides security and stability. Part of that stability has been the right to pass the tenure from parent to child if needed. Under the Conservative-led coalition government of 2010 to 15, this right was severely undermined, and I believe it has done serious damage to people in my constituency and many others across the country. I'll give way to the Honourable Gentleman.
Congratulations, Delegate, for Bethnal Green and Bow for bringing it forward. I've been a great supporter of social housing over the years, and I understand exactly the point that she's making. Does the Honourable Lady not agree that there needs to be a legal capability of associations to have limited discretion to ensure that qualified and experienced staff can use wisdom and discernment to ensure that justice and succession policy is able to be carried out within the policy? In other words, make it possible.
I very much agree with that point. I think that it needs to be, people need to be given the right advice and legal framework to apply, or mistakes can be made, and I will come on to some of those. And individuals in public organisations, housing associations, local authorities find themselves in a very difficult situation, very difficult position where they feel they have to apply the law but the law's application the law itself is flawed, which is why we need action from the government. Section 160 of the Localism Act of 2011 ended the right of those other than spouses or civil partners to succeed secure tenancies agreed after the 1st of April 2012. The Localism Act passed decision-making to local authorities without clear central guidance, meaning that many more bereaved children have been faced with eviction on the death of their parent, and in the depths of their grief have had to fight the bureaucracy and often legal threats to stay in their homes while they are dealing with the consequences of losing a family member. The Code of Guidance on the Allocation of Accommodation for Local Authorities, issued in 2002, included guidance on when it might be appropriate to grant a tenancy to members of a household. For example, where they have been living with the tenant for a year prior to the tenant's death, or have been providing care, or accepted responsibility for the tenant's dependence and needs, and their need to live in the family home. Mr. Deputy Speaker, many children. Sorry, Mr. Speaker. Okay, seeing the Deputy, Madam Deputy Speaker there. Mr. Speaker, there are many examples of caring responsibilities that people have fulfilled for many years, and they shouldn't be treated like this. Left to their own devices, the whole house will understand why local authorities prioritise those in need on the housing waiting list, and where they are put in an impossibly difficult situation and having to make difficult choices. But this does not balance out the needs of vulnerable people in homes who are at risk of being made homeless and treated inhumanely, unsympathetically, at a time of bereavement. Mr. Speaker, no one is saying that large family homes, should be occupied by single tenants. Indeed, the 2002 guidance made this clear. And no one is saying that the rent book should stay with the same family in perpetuity. And I know all too well, as the MP for Bethnal Green and Bow, of the desperate need for more affordable homes and an end in overcrowding and appalling housing conditions. And that essentially the rationing of housing has meant that even in these cases, people are being threatened with eviction because of the legal changes that were made under the Localism Act. But surely it is an unintended consequence and a pernicious consequence of the Localism Act. And the ways in which it is interpreted by local councils and housing associations, that it means that people are facing homelessness at the very time when they need support from the state, when they need solace, when they need to not have to think about whether they're going to be safe and allowed to live in their homes. If ever there was a need for a humane and flexible approach, it is this. I'm thinking of so many cases I've had to deal with over the past few years. Families with caring responsibilities who've had to fight multiple eviction notices, having just buried family members. Of older children who've given up their own council properties because they can't afford private accommodation or to buy, and have moved in to look after a parent for many years, but then are faced with eviction when the parent has died. One of those constituents moved out of his own council property to care for his father, who suffered a number of serious health and mobility issues. After successfully registering to have him and his wife had added to his father's tenancy agreement, the Housing Association sent a letter just 2 days after his father's death to explain that it may not be possible. This constituent of mine eventually received an eviction notice. I am pleased to report that ultimately he was allowed to stay after the Housing Association reversed their decision. But the trauma of having to go through that so soon after experiencing the death of a family member should never have happened. Another constituent who wanted to succeed her late mother's tenancy, having lived in the property since the late 80s, and that is her main home, the constituent suffers from a number of health issues. She does feel, the Housing Association East End Homes appropriately applied discretion in their succession rights, but now faces eviction. There have been many cases where constituents of mine have been wrongly served eviction notices in these circumstances of bereavement. I even have a case, had a case where a constituent came to my surgery having just lost her partner of 19 years and was wrongly told that she could not succeed his tenancy. In one case, the combination of the eviction threat and the bereavement faced by my constituent after having cared for her mother for over a decade was driving her to the edge of a nervous breakdown. She came to my surgery. She was worried about bailiffs coming to her house, having received eviction notices, and that she'd be thrown out. And the only thing I could offer her was that I would go there and stand with her, and I would do whatever it was needed to help her so that she didn't get seriously ill as a result of the pressure and the harassment, in essence, that she was experiencing at the hands of the state. There are so many cases that we've had to fight, and I know many honourable members across the House would have come across these cases. This is no way to treat hardworking and caring family members who are saving billions of pounds through caring responsibilities that otherwise the state would have had to take more of some responsibility in, and we should be supporting them, especially in bereavement, rather than punishing them. So what can we do? In so many cases, it is too late for those who've experienced this treatment. People have been evicted from their homes, subject to needless concern and worry and stress, and it has affected their mental health and well-being, and in other cases has been much more severe than that. And being treated by local authorities, by national government through the legislation in this way is wrong. So in the future, surely we can do better. Surely we can have some cross-party agreement to look at this issue, look at the number of cases around the country, because it's very hard for us to get the aggregate statistics of the impact on our constituents across the country. But this is a major problem. So I strongly urge all local administrators to be made to adopt a humane, compassionate policy for those facing such difficulties, and that their government should instruct them to stop sending eviction notices to our constituents when they are in bereavement, and that there should be a significant length of time before these matters are considered about whether they should remain in the properties that they have got, they are in resident of, even if they are larger properties, so that they have the appropriate time to bereave and recover. I'm extremely grateful to ministers and honourable members across the House for remaining in this debate, given that we are in the midst of election campaigning. This is an issue that I appreciate may well get drowned out in the election campaign, because there are many other big issues such as Brexit and other public services, the NHS and many others that we will want to talk about. But I hope that when the next team of ministers return to the House, we can all agree that we need action. So I ask the Minister to address the following points. Does she agree with me that passing a tenancy to an appropriate person who might be a relative, a child, a carer, can be an appropriate way of maintaining stability and making sure that the parent gets the right support and the child, often it's an adult child, is not made homeless, and that is that they are not punished for providing the duty of care to their family member. What assessment has she made of the workings of the Localism Act with regard to tenancy succession for those family members who have been carers for many years? How many cases end up in court, and at what cost, both financial to residents but also personal costs in terms of health and well-being? Does she not agree that we need national guidance with clarity on how local agencies and authorities should treat people in these circumstances, and that local authorities must not use eviction notices or bailiffs in some cases, to threaten our constituents with evictions when they are suffering and bereaving? It is utterly unacceptable. It's a wider point about the use of bailiffs by local authorities that this government needs to act on, because in circumstances like this we can see how much damage it does, not to mention the wider consequences and damage to people. What steps will she take to ensure that there are these common standards and that public servants take the appropriate sensitive actions in these times of need? And finally, will she commit to a timetable to deliver change? In conclusion, Mr. Speaker, to lose a parent or a relative is a terrible blow. The aftermath requires a suitable period of grieving and healing, and the amount of time required will vary between different people. Those of us who have grieved for loved ones will know that you can't put a fixed timetable to grief and recovery of grief. And just because the people we're talking about, people I'm talking about, are not wealthy, do not have the means to own their own properties, do not have the resources, but have cared for a loved one, does not mean that their suffering should be treated in this way, that they should not be treated compassionately for what they are doing for their families, but also for the public service as well as the duty of care and love that they have shown their family members, their loved ones, as they have their lives have come to an end and provided them the dignity that they should have rightly, that we should make sure that they are treated in a dignified, caring way. Thank you.
Thank the Honourable Lady for her speech, including the very kind remarks that she made at the start. As we